كلام سيدنا مولانا أبي عبد الله الحسين عليه السلام في يوم عاشوراء أنه قال: أيها الناس، إن الله تعالى خلق الدنيا فجعلها دار فناء وزوال، متصرفة بأهلها حالا بعد حال، فالمغرور من غرته والشقي من فتنته، فلا تغرنكم هذه الدنيا فإنها تقطع رجاء من ركن إليها وتخيب طمع من طمع فيها. صدق مولانا الإمام الحسين صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. ومن المؤمنات، brothers and sisters، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Next week, inshallah, will be the beginning of the holy month of Muharram. And unlike almost all nations in the world, who, to the best of my knowledge, celebrate the beginning of their new year, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhim ajma'in, they are the ones who start mourning and become in the state of grief in the beginning of the new year. And that is, of course, due to the tragedy that occurred on the 10th day of Muharram with the martyrdom of Al-Imam Al-Husayn, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. On the day of Ashura, Imam Al-Husayn, salamullahi alayhi, tried to make it clear. In fact, he did make it clear to all those who are facing him, why he's rising, what is he fighting for, and try to bring them back to their senses. In the words that I just read, he said, "O people, indeed Allah the Exalted created this world, and he made it a temporal place that will end and perish." This world is not gonna last. This dunya is not gonna be there forever. So here he is talking to these individuals who are being trenched in the love of dunya to the point that they're coming to kill the son of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He's trying to wake them up. This dunya that you're so busy in love with, it's not gonna be lasting. And then it changes the state of its inhabitants from one form to another. Today we are here. Tomorrow will be deep under, and this beautiful flesh and all these ornaments will be taken away. One day, Dawood alayhi salam, the prophet, he was walking and he came across a mountain. On the mountain, there was a prophet by the name of Hizqil. He said, "Ya Hizqil, do you give me permission to ascend the mountain and see you?" When Hizqil gave him the permission, he ascended. Hizqil was a prophet who lived on that mountain, lived in a cave in that mountain, and spent his whole life there. Dawood alayhi salam asked him, he said, "Ya Hizqil, you've spent your whole life here devoting yourself to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." He said, "Yes." He said, "Can I ask you some questions?" "Go ahead." He said, "Have you ever thought to yourself that, look at me, I've spent my whole time in ibadah. My whole life is for the sake of Allah. So there is no one really better than who I am." This is what's called ujb. Shaitan comes to us sometimes, to the mu'mineen, through these tools, ujb. Shaitan doesn't come to the mu'min and go tell him, for example, go party. He knows that doesn't work with him. He'll come to him through other means. That, look at me, I am the one who's donating the most to the community. There's no one better than I am. I am the one who invests most of my time in ibadah, going for hajj, for ziyarah. I'm the best there is. That's called ujb, wal-iyadu billah. That's another problem where we start to become over-proud of what we do. Here is Dawood asking Hizqil, "Do you have that feeling?" He said, "Never. No matter how much I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I would not even make up for one meal that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides me with. One meal. No matter if I spend that whole life of mine thanking Allah. And if you think about it, we're sitting down here right now, most of us, alhamdulillah, our hearts are beating. And we don't even feel it. We don't even realize it. This ni'mah that is happening inside as we are sitting right now, the breath that we're taking in, every ni'mah of Allah, we're being showered with His blessings, with His mercy. Problem is, the human being, unfortunately, does not really appreciate, does not show his gratitude to his Creator. So he tells him, then ya Hizqil, Dawud asks Prophet Hizqil, Hizqil, you're living in a cave in such a place. Do you feel sometimes that you would like to enjoy the ornaments of dunya? You know, go out, have fun, have something. You're living here in a cave, don't own anything. Does that thought ever cross your mind? And he said, yes, that one does come to my mind. So how do you deal with it, ya Hizqil? He said, I go into that cave and I learn from what's inside that cave. And I come out. He said, do you give me permission to go in? Go ahead. He goes in. He finds a skeleton sleeping on a bed with a pillow made up of iron. Next to it, there is a writing. He picks up the writing. He reads it. The writing says, Ana Arwa ibn Aslam. My name is Arwa ibn Aslam. I lived for 1,000 years. I ruled as a king 1,000 cities. And I built 1,000 cities. When my time came, the snakes were my neighbors. This metal was my pillow. And the sand was my bed. So whomever reads this, let him learn that this world is not going to be lasting. Dawood read this, and he said, now I understand. We sometimes, unfortunately, in this dunya, become so immersed into its love that we disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the expense of this dunya. Imam al-Hussein continues. He says, it changes the state of its inhabitants from one form to another. That king who was mighty, strong, now he is just a skeleton. He's in a different form altogether, different state. And sometimes, even when they're alive, one day you might have a king, and how many times have we seen this in our lifetime, within the past 15, 20 years? How many times have you seen a king or a president or a ruler, and the next day he's found in a hole, in the prison, in a pipe, or God knows where? How many times have we seen this? One day he was in one state, the next day he's in a different state. This is dunya. This is the reality of dunya. Then he continues, the arrogant one deceived by it. The arrogant, deceived by it. And the wicked is the one lured by it. It lures you. That's why Imam Ali alayhi salam was doing sujood in the middle of the desert, in the middle of the night, and talking to dunya, saying, Ya dunya, ghurri ghayri, a ilayya aqbalti, am ilayya tashawwaqti, umruki qasir, wa aishuki haqir, wa khataruki kabir, ah, min qillat al-zad, wa bu'd al-tariq, wa mashaqqat al-safar. He's crying in the middle of the night. He's saying, dunya, are you trying to lure me? Please me, your life is too short. You're full of problems and difficulties. And then he says, adatu ta'awwuh. It means you're in pain. You know how in English, for example, you say, ouch. When you're in pain, you say, ouch. He's saying, he's in pain. What is painful? Bu'd al-tariq. وَمَشَقَّةِ السَّفَرِ وَقِلَّةِ الزَّادِ. My travel is so long. My journey is a long journey, but I don't have enough baggage on me to carry me through that journey. If you want to travel for a month, what do? You prepare yourself for 1 month. You make sure you have enough clothes, you have enough things that with you to survive you that whole month. He says, I don't have much on that long journey. And he's crying. That is Ali ibn Abi Talib, who is Imam al-Muttaqeen, Amir al-Mu'mineen. What about you and I and our journey? What should we be saying? Imam salamullahi alayhi says, that's why the wicked is the one lured by it, by this dunya. So do not let this world, this dunya, fool you. For it cuts the hope of the one who leans against it. You think you have support in dunya? Guess what? Not much. You don't have much hope. It will cut the hope off. And it disappoints the greed of he who indulges in it. Among the values of the day of Ashura, brothers and sisters, that we will be coming across, inshallah, next week, and many mu'mineen and mu'minat come and attend the majalis. Jazakumullahu khaira. Indeed, attending the majalis is very important. Try to come, try to bring your children, try to attend. This is the time when we are learning experiences for us and our children. Time of transformation. How many people, their lives have transformed because of attending the majalis of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. How many people found the light of guidance through these majalis? Don't let go of the majalis. Attendance is important, but another factor which is extremely important is how can we learn and implement what we learn from these majalis? That's something for us to ask ourselves before we go in, that this Muharram, what am I going to learn? How am I going to implement what I learned? 3 points I will touch upon. Among the aim of Muharram, I will use the acronym AIM, A, I, and M. 3 points to think about, A, I, and M. The A is for assistantship, to be of an assistance to fellow brothers and sisters, to mu'mineen and mu'minat. This is one of the aims of the day of Ashura, to always be there for others. On the eve of Ashura, one of the companions of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam receives news while he's in Karbala that his son has been captured and is taken by some bandits as a prisoner, and they're demanding a ransom for his release. This news arrived on the eve of Ashura to this companion of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Imam al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi, who looked at him, even though Imam al-Husayn was in the most need of companions, of supporters. However, he also knows what it means to be a father and what it means to have your son being captured by people threatening to kill him. So he approaches him. He brings him some garments of clothes that are worthy. They have some worth, they have some value, expensive. He gives them to him. He said, take this. The value of these garments is about 1,000 dirham. That's quite valuable here. Take them. And take them and go to these bandits. Free your son. Look at this attitude of help. Helping. Even though when he is in most need of the assistance, he needs his companions. On the day of Ashura, he's crying, Hal min nasirin yansuruna? Is there anyone to help us? He needs help. But he knows he's a father. He comes to him, he says, take these garments, you go. The man looks at Imam al-Husayn and says, Ya Aba Abdullah, and what is my son compared to you? Let him be sacrificed. Let him be killed. Imam al-Husayn then looks at him and he says, listen, okay, if you want to stay, all right, send your other son who's with you now. His other son was with him. He said, give these garments to your son. Let him go free his brother. So the father then sends the second son. He tells the son, okay, son, you take these garments and you go. This is one of the lessons of Ashura, one of the aim of Ashura, assistance. How much do we assist each other as a community? How much do we stand for one another as a community? And not expecting anything in return. Sometimes we help, but I expect something back. I'll help you because one day you'll help me. I'll need your help as well. That's called business. That's business. Because what is business? Business is when you trade. You give something with an agreement. I give you something, you give me something in exchange. That's business. Our relationship sometimes as a community is that of a relationship of business. I'll attend your wedding so that you attend my wedding. I'll be there for your funeral so that you'll be there for mine. You are wealthy, you are good, so I'll help you today so that you'll help me when I need you. That's our relationships. That's the relationship of business. Our relationship should be that of brotherhood. We're brothers. We're one. The Prophet says, Mu'mineen are like one body. When part of it aches, the rest of it comes to its rescue. If something hurts you, it hurts me. If I can help you stand on your feet, I'm helping myself to get up. Because we're one. Can we have such a concept instilled in our hearts where we help as a community, not expecting anything in return except His pleasure? Except His pleasure. Do we have that? That's something important for us to think about. Assistance, helping one another and assisting one another as a community. I is for our Iman. On the eve of Ashura, Umar ibn Sa'd decides to march on the camp of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam calls Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas salamullahi alayhi, and he says, Ya Abu al-Fadl, you go and tell them to give us the night. Let us wait. Let them wait for this one night. Because I would like to invest this night in salat. فَإِنَّ رَبِّي يَعْلَمْ أَنِّي أُحِبُّ الصَّلَاةِ. My Lord knows that I love salat. I want to spend this one more night in salat, in ibadah, in iman. The camp of Imam al-Husayn, it is said on that eve of Ashura, was like bees buzzing. One is praying, one is reading Quran, one is doing dua, dhikr, like bees. Iman. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam stood on the day of Ashura and sacrificed for the sake of the salat, for the sake of the siyam, for the sake of the religion. Usually, brothers and sisters, when you sacrifice something, it is usually of a lesser value than what you've sacrificed for. Usually. When you sacrifice something, when you give something up, it's usually for something that's much bigger, much more important, much more valuable. Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam sacrificed his life. What for? Something that's very valuable. And that is the religion of Islam. How many prophets have been killed? How many imams? All of them except the last one have been killed. What for? So that this religion of Islam stands. Would that then make us appreciate this religion and give it some significance? One of the ulama, may Allah bless his soul, whenever he used to pray, before he starts the salat, before he says Allahu Akbar, he would say, Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. And then he says, Allahu Akbar. He was asked one day, why do you do this? He said, because if it weren't for the sacrifice of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam on the day of Ashura, I would not be standing here on the musalla to say Allahu Akbar. أشهد أنك قد أقمت الصلاة وآتيت الزكاة وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر وأطعت الله ورسوله حتى أتاك اليقين. On the day of Ashura, he takes his baby and he asks for water for his baby who gets killed right on his hands. He sees his son Ali al-Akbar being killed right in front of his hand, of his eyes. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, right in front of his eyes. All these sacrifices, then when we, as followers of Ahlul Bayt, are asked, listen people, don't be arrogant, be kind. My sisters, put on your hijab. Is that too much to ask for? Imam Hussein gave up his baby for the sake of this religion. Gave up his son, gave up his brother, gave himself for the sake of this religion. Is hijab too much to ask for then? Is giving out to the community too much to ask for then? Sacrificing some wealth? Something to think about. Iman, let's increase in our Iman. And that's not just by praying and fasting. Alhamdulillah, most of us do that. But let us improve on to the next point, which is the M, and that is for manners. A, I, and M, manners. Akhlaq. Akhlaq. Manners come from the heart. They're spontaneous. How is our manners? Let's look at Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. On the day of Ashura, Imam al-Hussein had a Turkish slave. He freed him on the day of Ashura. He told him, you can go. But he said, no, I'll stay with you. I won't leave you. And indeed, he fought in Karbala and fell down. As he fell down, Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam walked to him. In his last moments, Imam al-Hussein put his cheek on the cheek of this Turkish slave. That Turkish slave opened his eye. In these last moments, قَالَ مَنْ مِثْلِي وَخَدُّ بْنُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ عَلَىٰ خَدِّي. He said, who's like me when I have the cheek of the Prophet's son touching my cheek? And that's how he left this dunya. Imam al-Hussein then walks also to his son Ali al-Akbar and does the same thing. Where do you find such manners, such akhlaq? Is that our attitude towards people? Do you know what a slave is? A slave is someone who doesn't even own himself. If we're talking about the social realm, a slave is at the bottom of the social class because he doesn't even own himself. Yet Imam al-Hussein walks to this slave, although he freed him, but he walks to him, a man who has socially no class. And he puts his cheek over his cheek, the cheek of that. What for? What is he teaching us? People, be humble, be modest. Don't be fooled by this dunya. Don't let your large houses, nice cars fool you, because they will not go to the grave with you. When you give, give with pleasure. Don't give so that my name can go up. Who cares? Because that's a real challenge. It is our attitudes, our manners. These are one of the lessons of Ashura. Let us try to be in the line of Imam al-Hussein salamullahi alayhi. Let's try to work on our assistantship. So throughout this month of Ramadan, and I know many of you mu'mineen and mu'minat help those who are less fortunate. You give, you donate, which is great. Jazakum Allahu khaira. Many people in this world are in need of help, especially in this day and age. Give them. At the same time, let me think of ways how can I provide assistance to my fellow brothers and sisters here in this city? How can I become a source of barakah, mercy? Isa alayhi salam says, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتَ. Allah has made me blessed wherever I go. That mubarakah is يعني نفاعاً, means I am of benefit. Wherever I go, I help. Can I become like that? And how? There are all different ways we can work on them. Let's aim that this holy month of Muharram, let me work on my iman, such that it's not just the salat and the siyam, but rather, let me elevate my status. Let me go up. If I'm not wearing hijab, let me put on the hijab. If I have a problem with my arrogance, let me fix my arrogance. If I have a problem with backbiting and ghibah, and talking to people, creating problems in the community, let me work on that. Because that's what really the essence of iman. That's the essence of iman. And let me work on my manners, such that I become an individual who is most servitude to Ahlul Bayt. And let us try to attend the majalis because they help us. One of the ulama one day saw Habib ibn Madahir al-Asadi in the dream. And he told him, Ya Habib, if you were to come back to this dunya, what would you do? He said to him, I would attend the majalis of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn. Now that I'm here in this dunya, in this part of the world, in this other side, I see how valuable they are. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq and the ability to truly achieve the aim of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the tawfiq and the ability to serve in the majalis of al-Imam al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us and our children until the day of judgment among the sincere followers of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi majma'een. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us their shafa'a in dunya, in the qabr, and in the hereafter. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr, illa alladhina amanu wa amilu s-salihati wa tawasaw bil-haqq wa tawasaw bil-sabr. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alihi. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين المصطفى بالقاسم محمد ثم الصلاة والسلام على ابن عمه أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين ويعسو بالدين أسد الله الغالب المولى علي بن أبي طالب ثم الصلاة والسلام على ابنته البتول الطاهرة سيدة نساء العالمين الزهراء فاطمة ثم الصلاة والسلام على سبطي نبي الرحمة وسيدي شباب أهل الجنة الإمامين الزكيين الشهيدين الحسن والحسين ثم الصلاة والسلام على التسعة المعصومين من ذرية الحسين علي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي باقر علم النبيين وجعفر بن محمد الصادق البار الأمين وموسى بن جعفر الكاظم وعلي بن موسى الرضا ومحمد بن علي الجواد وعلي بن محمد الهادي والحسن بن علي الزكي العسكري ثم الصلاة والسلام على وصي الحسن الخلف الحجة القائم المنتظر المهدي عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل الساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوى وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله، وبحق من ناجاك وبحق من دعاك في البر والبحر، أن تتفضل على فقراء المؤمنين والمؤمنات بالغناء والثروة، وعلى مرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات بالشفاء والصحة، وعلى أحياء المؤمنين والمؤمنات باللطف والكرامة، وعلى أموات المؤمنين والمؤمنات بالمغفرة والرحمة، وعلى غرباء المؤمنين والمؤمنات بالرد إلى أوطانهم سالمين غانمين. اللهم وارحم المؤمنين والمؤمنات في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. عباد الله، إماء الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله وبالأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر. Brothers and sisters, this week or this month, we have an important event that is happening, which is the elections. Elections are coming up, and it's important for us to participate in this elections. We are Canadians. We're proud to be Canadians. We live in this Canadian society, and it's important for our voices to be heard. Just yesterday, in fact, some of you may have read the Globe and Mail. There was an article about a lady in niqab who herself is saying that I'm not oppressed, I'm educated, I'm wearing this as choice. But the prime minister said, we cannot allow anyone to have these backward cultural values to impede women. And I'm just wondering, why make an issue out of something that's not even an issue? How many people in Canada actually wear the niqab anyways, in the first place? Why make this big deal out of something that's not even a big deal? We have so many issues that we need to attend to. And in the past, this prime minister has also said the biggest threat for Canada are the Islamists. Okay. Which is an interesting term. In fact, I remember I wrote an article that was published in Edmonton back when I was there about what does the prime minister really mean by Islamists? Now, what's the difference between Muslims and any other Canadians? Alhamdulillah, we're among the top most educated community in all of Canada. We're working hard, we pay taxes. Are we any less Canadian than any other Canadian? What else do you want us to do? We work hard, we're educated, we serve our communities, we serve our societies, we pay our taxes. What else can we do? If that is not Canadian, tell me what is Canadian. So brothers and sisters, it's important for us to participate, to get involved. There are some mu'mineen who are trying to help with these issues, some agencies who are trying to help. So if you ever have questions, you can resort to them. But let's importantly try to get out and vote so that our voices are heard. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us and this whole world, inshallah, with peace and security. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hasten the reappearance of our 12th Imam, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif, such that we can witness the day when this earth is filled with justice, the way it is being filled with tyranny and oppression. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul huwallahu ahad, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.